Welcome, everyone, to Jimmy V Week on ESPN as we continue our commitment to the V Foundation for Cancer Research in tribute to Jim Valvano and his dream to defeat cancer. We're here at Madison Square Garden for the Jimmy V Classic. It's a doubleheader in game number one. Two top 20 teams as Butler will take on Georgetown. Then in the nightcap, it'll be Indiana facing Pittsburgh out of the Big East. That one at 9 o'clock Eastern time. And welcome inside Madison Square Garden, everyone. I'm John Saunders. The 15th year as we continue to honor the memory of Jim Valvano and his promise to beat cancer. I'm joined once again by Digger Phelps, Coach Bob Knight, and Jay Bellis. And each time of this year, Digger, I'm reminded how much I miss my friend. But I'm also reminded how much has been done on his behalf.
From that speech before he died in 93, what Valvano did for everybody is give anything and everything you can from his mind, his spirit, his soul that led to this hope to where now, $90 million later, and what has happened with the way to go after cancer, it's second to none. And as he said, it's not over till it's over. So this is the team he's put together, Bob, and one of the great teams ever to take on that challenge to beat cancer.
You know, I don't think that there's anything that you can do, either physically or financially, with all of the problems that we have in our country today, than try to find a cure for cancer. And I think the Jimmy V Foundation has been at the forefront in that regard. And I think it's interesting that here tonight, Jay had played against Jimmy's teams.
I did.
Obviously a great coach, but you know, we were all products of team sports, and we were drawn to it because we could be a part of something bigger than ourselves and accomplish something that we couldn't accomplish alone. And what Jim Valvano did with the help of ESPN and all of us, and you especially, John, is put together an unbelievable team. And look what that team's accomplished to this point, and how close we are to accomplishing the ultimate goal. It's really incredible.
Jim Valvano is still coaching us to this very day. Now, as we do each and every year between games, we will play Jimmy's now famous 1993 ESPY speech, plus plenty more. We'll tell you the number to call, where to go online, so that you can help donate and help us beat cancer. Remember, 100% of your donation goes towards cancer research. Now time to join the gentlemen who call the game, Dan Schulman and Dick Vitale.
John, thank you very much. We'll get to basketball in a moment, but as we said, a big night because of people like John and yourself, a dear friend of yours, Jim Valvano. This is a special night for everybody involved with the V Foundation.
Well, you know, Dan, certainly his legacy to me will not be cutting the nets down and winning that national title, but it's going to be all the lives that he's affected for generation after generation. And to me, that's a sign of a genuine champion. Right now, as Digger mentioned, $90 million has been raised. And I'm so proud to be part of the best team I've ever been with, the V Foundation.
Now let's talk about what's going to go on the court tonight as we combine in basketball and a great opportunity to raise funds for a terrific cause. We're going to see two ranked teams, two good teams here early in the season.
Well, we're going to see two good teams. And number one, we're going to see Georgetown and getting their first real test. And they got a superstar player you're going to love, fans, watching this kid pass the ball at 6'11". Mr. Monroe handles it, very agile. He's just got to become a little bit more hostile, a little bit more aggressive. But I also love the kid at Butler, Mr. Versatility, Gordon Hayward, multi-dimensional, can flat out shoot the three. This is going to be a real test because up till now, Georgetown has not played the caliber of competition they will face in Butler.
Yeah, Butler's had a rugged schedule so far. That's why they've lost a couple of games. Georgetown is still unbeaten this year. Let's go to the Star Watch now, and the same two guys that Dick alluded to in the open as we begin with Gordon Hayward of Butler, one of the exciting young players, 6'9", but can play inside and outside. Great ball handling, great passing, just a sophomore, as is Greg Monroe, the multi-talented and a multi-dimensional man in the middle for the Georgetown Hoyas. Monroe, the freshman of the year in the Big East a year ago. The starting lineups now as we begin with Butler. The Bulldogs bring back every single player from a 26-win team a year ago. In the backcourt, Ronald Norridge, Sheldon Mack, Willie Beasley can cover anybody from a point guard right up to a center. We've talked about Gordon Hayward. And then there's Matt Howard, who was the Horizon League Player of the Year a year ago. For Georgetown, three starters back, and Chris Wright, Austin Freeman, and Greg Monroe. Jason Clark tremendously improved over the last 6 or 8 months. And Julian Vaughn doing a lot of the dirty work down low, getting a lot of rebounds for Georgetown. For more on tonight's matchup, let's bring in Doris Bird.
Hi, Dan. Well, if you ask people inside of the Butler program what is behind such consistent success for a mid-major, they will simply answer, it's the Butler way. And that's a system predicated on team over self, on humility, and on service. But if you ask John Thompson III about the system, he said, listen, this isn't simply about the how, it's the who. And in his words, Butler has got some pretty darn good players, and we'll get a look at all of them tonight, Dan.
All right, Doris, thank you. I like that. Not just about the how, it's about the who. And for Georgetown, they really struggled in the second half of last year. Remember that big win they had over Connecticut? They beat Memphis, they beat Syracuse, and then they just went downhill over the last couple of months. They kind of lost their togetherness. They lost games they should have won. They ended up losing in the first round of the NIT.
Well, you know, I really think what happened to them, they were a victim of the toughness of the league. The league was so tough. And what really hurt them, Dan, there was a three-game stretch where they lost three in a row to Seton Hall, Cincinnati, and Marquette, and that really broke their back. Because they had that great win, as you said, Connecticut on the road. You and I did the game.
That's
beat
right.
Memphis.
Yep.
They really, really were playing really well early.
Butler, meanwhile, a team that's gone to the NCAA tournament 8 of the last 13 years, including the last 3 in a row, got knocked out in the first round of last year. Everybody back looking to go deeper here this year. John Cal, Bob Donato, and Michael Stevens are the officials. We're glad you're with us here at Madison Square Garden for the doubleheader here, the Jimmy V Classic. The doubleheader, Indiana and Pittsburgh, will be game number 2 tonight. We are underway in game 1 with the Hoyas wearing gray, getting the first possession of the game. And you'll notice the big guys step out a lot, especially Monroe. A lot of the offense runs through him. He'll come out to the high post. He'll pass. He'll take outside shots. And kind of a modified Princeton offense, as they call it. You'll see some backdoor cuts as well, and they'll use a lot of the clock, Dick.
Yeah, they really get a lot of motion, and the one thing, as you mentioned, Monroe can really pass the ball.
Chris Wright misses the three. Jason Clark, the offensive rebound, and a fresh 35.
They really like Clark. They think that Clark adds a lot of energy to the club, makes shots from the perimeter.
Austin Freeman makes a shot from the perimeter, 3-0 Hoyas.
I said Freeman's got some body, very strong. Came in with a big reputation out of DeMatha. Also, Chris Wright came in with a big reputation out of Washington, D.C.
Good position inside. Matt Howard can't finish, though.
He's very
rebound to Julian Vaughn.
You know, Howard very effective in a low box. Didn't go up there real strong, but he goes to the foul line a great deal because he's so aggressive down in the low box.
They've got to keep him out of foul trouble. That's been the biggest problem for him in the early going.
One thing about Butler, they're going to keep you in the game, Dan. They're not going to blow you out. They're not going to run up and down the court. A lot of patience.
Sheldon Mack, air ball on the three. Butler, usually a team that takes high percentage shots. They don't turn it over. They've had a rough schedule so far, playing a lot of good teams. But at times this year, they haven't quite been themselves. Their losses are to Minnesota and Clemson, the only two ranked teams they've played until tonight, as Julian Vaughn makes it 5-0.
He's an important player. He was a transfer out of Florida State. Really struggled last year. But they need him on the interior to give some help to Monroe.
Good position inside again by Howard. The reverse bounces off the rim. You can see early the size of Georgetown. Monroe and Vaughn has been a bit of a problem for Howard on the inside. Vaughn turns it over almost as Freeman gets it back. And now they do turn it over. Butler not a team that'll push it very often.
They got to get some looks for Hayward. Hayward's certainly a guy that can make the three.
There he is, driving on Monroe, and a touch foul on Greg Monroe. But the Georgetown Hoyas are ranked 13th in the nation right now. They are 6-0, one close game, a win over Temple. Otherwise, they've had some pretty big wins against lesser opposition. The defensive numbers, though, are impressive for the Hoyas in the early going.
Yeah, the defensive numbers are impressive, but Dan, as you said so well, really have not been tested other than a Temple game. They're going to test it this week playing Butler, and they're playing Washington down in Anaheim.
The John Wooden Classic. Mack. And a turnover. Chris Wright's got the loose ball for the Hoyas.
Very strong, very athletic, playing that point.
Monroe down to the post on this trip. Good help by Hayward. Another Georgetown turnover. Noren, the point guard, not a big-time scorer. Hayward blocked. Vaughn got him.
Hey, Vaughn brings that shot blocking ability and rebounding ability as well.
And Chris Wright calling for the carry. Boy, turnovers plaguing both teams, but you talked about the early impact Julian Vaughn has had tonight.
Yeah, he can block shots. Let's look at John Thompson the third. Going to watch Vaughn on the interior. There's the drive by Hayward. Vaughn rotates over. A good block shot with the left hand. Hey, this is a tough stretch for Butler. Think about it. Three games in a row. Georgetown, Ohio State, and Xavier.
Yeah, and Ohio State and Xavier, though, are playing them at Hinkle Fieldhouse in Indianapolis. So Butler playing home and homes with some pretty big-name teams. They've already played Minnesota, UCLA, Clemson.
Well, UCLA on a real struggle.
Yeah.
Plus four in a row. Ben Holland's too good. He'll get things turned around. Trust me.
Howard off to Hayward, who knocks down a three. What a talent this young man is. 6'9". You know, as a freshman in high school, he was about 5'9", but had a late growth spurt. He's got guard skills in a big man's body.
You know, that's why he was not really a big-time recruit. And he also was a great tennis player.
That's right.
And he grew, like you said, about 7-8 inches. His sister plays tennis right now down at Butler.
Mack with a steal. No call, and there is a call. Couldn't hear the whistle here in the Garden as it goes in for Sheldon Mack. The foul on Austin Freeman, and the Bulldogs have roared back to tie it.
Well, Mack's a very important player to this club. He gives them that good perimeter play, very strong with the basketball. There he is, defense a little bit slow coming over. He's from out of Lexington, Kentucky. He told me before the game, I said, Lexington, Wildcats. How come you're not wearing a Wildcat uniform? He said, they didn't recruit me hard. They offered me one at the end, but it was too late. Mr. Gillespie came in too late.
And you saw the note of them there at the foul line. He was the captain of the 19 and under Team USA that won the gold medal in the summer down in New Zealand. Jamie Dixon of Pittsburgh coached that team, and there were two Bulldogs on the team, Hayward along with Mack, and Mack the captain of a talented all-star team. Jamie Dixon told us earlier today, kind of a no-brainer. He's got incredible passion for the game, Mack does, and he was an easy choice as captain.
And also playing a vital point on the team is Darius Miller, who we're going to see tomorrow in that game against Connecticut for Kentucky.
Yeah, got another doubleheader here at the Garden tomorrow, the Big East SEC Challenge. Georgia, St. John's in the first game, Kentucky and UConn in the nightcap.
Can't wait for that. Calipari and Mr. Calhoun come into the house of the Garden.
Monroe. Blocked.
They're doing a great job packing the defense inside on Monroe. Really taking away any driving angles.
The 2009 Jimmy V Classic is brought to you by Public Enemies, starring Johnny Depp, now on Blu-ray, High Def, and DVD, rated R.
We ask you to call, to go online, to make a donation. Every single dollar you donate goes directly to the V Foundation, directly to cancer research. Over $90 million has been raised over the years, but there's a lot of work still to be done.
Well, obviously, we need more cash. Think about this. Every minute, someone in America is losing their life to cancer. 1,500 will lose their life to cancer today alone. 560,000 in the year will lose their life to cancer. I will tell you this. One out of every two males, one out of every three females will come down with cancer. So please, I beg you, call 1-800-4-JIMMY-V. Make a donation. The life you save could be someone you love.
And a cause that's near and dear to the heart of Georgetown coach John Thompson III. His wife, Monica, is a breast cancer survivor. And he said he didn't care how, he didn't care who, he wanted to be in this event. He does a lot of great work in the D.C. area raising money for cancer research. And this was very important for John Thompson to be in this event.
Yeah, he told me before the game that he's really excited to be part of the game. He only wishes the competition wasn't as tough. But he's also very happy. His wife right now is in remission. And that's the good news, Darren. Right now, 12 million cancer survivors able to get on with their lives because of the research.
Great ball movement by the Bulldogs. The three a little strong for Mack. Offensive rebound. Hayward.
I tell you, Hayward's so versatile. I know Mike DeCourcy loves him from out of Sporting News, and I can see why.
Jason Clark comes up with the steal and the jam. Clark is 6'2", but has very long arms, great quickness. He had five steals in a game earlier this year for the Hoyas.
Yeah, he anticipates really well, and what they love about him, he brings a lot of energy to the club. Something they felt they missed last year. And they were so inexperienced. I mean, Wright, Freeman, all young guys, Monroe.
Easily the most improved player in the offseason with all the work he did is Jason Clark. Mack, another miss. Butler's getting good looks from beyond the arc. Open looks. but not knocking them down. Jason Clark beyond the NBA line for three.
Tell you, he can shoot that long three. The one thing about Butler, should be a good shooting team now. They have not shot well. The last game they did, the last game against Valpo, but five games prior to that, they struggled shooting a rock.
Jason Clark, the sophomore out of Arlington, Virginia, averaging better than 12 points, 5 rebounds, 2.5 steals per game in the early going. And we just saw a steal and a dunk and then about a 25-foot three-pointer from Jason Clark, and the Hoyas are back on top.
You know, he's got that long, lean look, very aggressive.
Zach Hahn into the game now for Butler, wearing number 3. Clark defending him.
He can shoot the 3.
Yep.
Now he's coming to the game because he's a good perimeter shooter. Matt Stevens says he's really concerned that they're not shooting the ball as well as they're capable of.
Hayward almost walked, got the ball down just in time, and it's knocked out of bounds. It will be Georgetown ball as we check in with Doris Burke.
Well, guys, due to Jason Clark's lean physique and tireless motor, John Thompson III has actually compared him to Allen Iverson. He said, it doesn't matter how long I play him, the guy simply doesn't wear out. That length, a factor on the defensive end, Dick.
I'll tell you one thing, Doris. He may say Allen Iverson, but Allen Iverson was in another league, man. That's an M&M-er. I like Mr. Clark. But Allen Iverson, wow. I think, by the way, a great signing for the 76ers. I mean, where are they going anyway?
Something.
Yeah, bring some excitement.
There's a foul on Matt Howard. We talked about it. The reigning Horizon League Player of the Year has fouled out of 4 games already this year. In Butler's first 8, he's averaging about a foul every 6 minutes. But Brad Stevens said he did the same thing last year. Then he figured out how to play without fouling. But they need him on the floor more than just 22, 24 minutes a game.
Well, they got to challenge him, take advantage of the size of Monroe. But Monroe was 11 for 28 in his last 2 games, and right now he has not gotten a good look yet inside.
Hollis Thompson, number 1, freshman into the game, and now for Georgetown. Off to Henry Sims, who missed in close, and back come the Bulldogs.
Sims gives him great size, he can block some shots, rebound.
Monroe jumped out of the passing lane. He was off to the races had that pass been made, and there's a foul inside going against the Hoyas. Well, we've got another doubleheader coming your way tomorrow night right here from Madison Square Garden, a part of the DirecTV SEC Big East Invitational at 7 o'clock Eastern over on ESPN2. It'll be Georgetown and St. John's. The Red Storm are improving. And then the big one on ESPN at 9:30 Eastern, number 4, Kentucky, and number 12, Connecticut.
The best diaper dandy in America will be here tomorrow. The best diaper dandy, Mr. Wall. Explosive, Mr. Clutch. I mean, this freshman, he's maybe a freshman classification. He's a man playing out the collegiate level already. Cats fans are in awe.
You saw leading all freshmen in the nation in scoring, 3rd among all collegiate players in assists at almost 8 per game. He is excited. Sims the lob inside. Howard got a piece of it, almost knocked it into his own basket, but it bounces Butler's way.
Now Butler's had 3 consecutive journeys to the NCAA tournament.
There's Hahn, the shooter. The lefty knocks it down.
Hey, scouting report, pretty
there
accurate.
Go, huh?
Scouting report says he can shoot the 3.
So Georgetown got the first 5. Butler the next 6 to take the lead. Georgetown the next 5. And now Butler 5 in a row. A game of runs so far here in the first 7 minutes. Nice move by Monroe.
He's so talented. It reminds me of when we talk about talent and potential. Ed Davis down in North Carolina. Both guys, you look at their numbers and you say to yourself, these guys should be 20 a night, 11, 12 rebounds when you watch their ability. But a lot of times people don't get them the ball at the right time.
And John Thompson will tell you that Greg Monroe's best asset is making his teammates better, but he likes being a facilitator more than a scorer.
Yeah, that's why you can't compare him with the former greats like Ewing and Mourning. They were a different style of player in the post.
Avery Jukes misses the jumper, and here comes Chris Wright. Full speed ahead for Wright. And he draws the foul. Now Greg Monroe, the freshman of the year for the Big East a year ago, better than 12 points, 6 rebounds per game. Is there more there this season?
I'll tell you one thing. He's so talented. Look at that agility for a big guy. Laying it up on just very agile, but a different style. Remember Ewing, certainly Mourning. They were physical.
Yeah.
They were just different kind of players. So when I see his name mentioned with them, it's really not fair.
He's more finesse than
like
physical
play. Wow, Dan Schumer finesse. Finesse. Hey, I want to thank
I got better than that.
Wait, I'm going to embarrass my buddy right here. And he knows I love him, think the world of he, his wife, Sarah, and his family. But he slipped me a check, and I thank you so much. A check, and I'm telling you some nice numbers for the V Foundation.
We should all, do what
thank
we can.
Thank you so much.
1-800, my pleasure. 1-800-4-JIMMY-V. JimmyV.org. We'll be reminding you about it all night long. This is the culmination of Jimmy V Week here on the ESPN family of networks. Is Gordon Hayward and Matt Howard, two of the stars on this Butler team, sit down. They are pretty deep. Brad Stevens will go 9 or 10 deep.
They just understand how to play. They're about a team. They really understand how to get open shots. Got a block right there.
Jukes the foul, his second. We will step aside here at the Garden. 3 points. Dick, you mentioned some of the facts a little bit earlier tonight. Cancer kills on average one American every minute of every day. And an estimated 12 million of cancer survivors are living in the United States today. We urge you, please, pick up the phone, call 1-800-4-JIMMY-V or go online, jimmyv.org. So many people work so hard to have made this foundation what it has become over the last 15 years. And I know you work very, very closely with some of these people. Tell us some of the names and some of the things they're doing.
Well, they're doing amazing jobs. You're talking about starting with Nick Valvano and the entire family. Bob Lloyd, his former teammate, started with him at Rutgers, has dedicated his life. Joyce Ashenbrenner, John Leschny. They work so hard and so passionate.
Here come the Bulldogs, down by three. Dan Shulman, Dick Vitale, Doris Burke, John Saunders, and the gang on the set. Just to our left here, as we bring you the Jimmy V Classic, the doubleheader here from the Garden. Nice move inside, left hand, Howard, no. And that's staying down so far for Matt Howard around the rim.
One thing with Howard, he usually finishes down low. You don't have many guys in the low blocks that are very effective. He's old school. He gets in there, he gets a lot of people in foul trouble. He's got to watch him on his own self get fouled out.
Another three, Austin Freeman, his second of the night.
Hey, the book was that Butler shoots the threes, but we're seeing Clark and Freeman knocking down threes. They came in with such a big reputation, right, Freeman.
And Monroe as well, three McDonald's All-Americans on this Georgetown team. Two of them now juniors, one a sophomore, as Beasley is fouled inside. Now, Austin Freeman didn't shoot the ball well last year, but this year it looks like he's in more of a comfort zone and the roles are kind of better defined on this year's team.
I'll tell you one thing. He's one of those guys that does a lot of bit of little stuff. He passes well, shoots well, moves without the ball. There he is stepping out, shooting the three. Very versatile. I think there's no doubt Wright and Freeman have to have big years. You know Monroe is going to have a solid year. Those guys have to have major big years because look at the conference. Everybody says slipped a little. Take a look at Villanova. Take a look at Syracuse. Take a look at West Virginia. Take a look at Connecticut. I mean, are you kidding me? And I say watch out for Seton Hall, Cincinnati. They could be sleepers. Even St. John's a lot better than what they've been.
St. John's played well, lost to Duke on the weekend. That was their first loss of the season, but they hung in that game for a while.
Well, beat Siena, beat Temple.
Another rebound for Monroe, already his fifth of the night. Good defense by Howard at the other end. And we talked about a game of runs so far here. It was Georgetown getting off to an early start, scoring the first 5 points of the game. Back came Butler, then the Hoyas. Back came Butler again, then the Hoyas again. So maybe it's time for Butler to get on a run and get back into this one.
Well, Butler to win the game's got to make threes. I mean, that is really one of their lethal weapons. Jay and I were talking before the game, but you can't give help. You can't give help against them because if you do give help, they're going to find the open three-point shooter.
Do you know, Dick, 46% of their field goal attempts are from three-point range, almost half their shots.
Hey, what about Villanova the other night? I think they took 36 threes against Maryland.
Monroe, and Howard is called for the foul, his second, and the biggest problem Butler's had so far this season has come up again here in this game.
They can't afford to lose him, especially tonight. And the reason they can't afford to lose him tonight is because of Monroe. They can't afford to have this guy go out. You might see them have to go to some zone. I know they're a man-to-man club. He can't believe they're going to call a foul there. He said, I just about touched him.
It looked like he did get him on the arm. Frustration for Brad Stevens, the 33-year-old head coach of the Butler Bulldogs. The player of the year in the Horizon League a year ago has to sit down. He's been doing way too much sitting and way too little playing so far this year for the Bulldogs.
Yeah, Brad Stevens doesn't want to see him as an assistant coach. Look at Brad. He looks about 14. Bobby Knight and I were talking inside. I said, Bob, can you imagine what he's going to look like when he's 50? Let him stay and coach him. But let me, he worked 6 years on the Todd Licklider, and we want to send our best wishes to Todd up in Iowa. He's had a little problems, had severe headaches. We wish you the best, Todd.
And apparently has been released from hospital, not expected to coach this week, but on his way to recovery. So we sent Coach Licklider the best.
Sent our best also to Evan Turner. Turner, what a serious fall. What a blow for the Buckeyes of Ohio State. One of the real talents in America. We really wish him the best. He had some fractures in his back area.
In his back after a dunk, kind of hung on to the rim, went horizontal, fell to the court, and is expected to be out up to 8 weeks. Hollis Thompson with the ball, number one. Exciting, talented, skilled freshman for the Hoyas. Monroe driving aggressively. Put back, no good. Freeman's got it.
They beat him on the glass, very aggressive. That's old style. John Thompson is sitting in the house. That's John Thompson's style when his kids play. Yep. Big John, man, they used to get on the glass. Every missed shot was an offensive opportunity.
10-0 run is over as Willie Beasley lays it in for the Bulldogs.
Beasley's one of those guys you talked about earlier. Great defender. Guard anybody on the floor, as my partner said earlier.
Senior from Freeport, Illinois. He's the only member of the Butler team to play in this building. They were in the NIT season tip-off 3 years ago when they won it, beating some very good teams, Tennessee Gonzaga, on their way to the championship.
Also, 3 years in a row, he's been to the NCAA tournament.
Nice move by Julian Vaughn. Well, you can see the improvement into both Jason Clark and Julian Vaughn from a year ago.
And I think you're going to see the improvement in Wright and Freeman being a little bit more consistent.
Hayward.
I think he's too unselfish. I think Hayward's going to start looking for a shot.
He does right now. Strong on the three, though. And then reaches in and commits a foul.
See, right now, as you look at the young coach on that sideline, how look at Monroe right now. Look at a great low post position. Look at right now. All he's got to do is spin this way. Drop step. There it is. Drop step. Little post move inside. And then the hustle. Look at the scrap and claw. That's going to make Big Daddy happy. Big John's going to smile.
Georgetown with a 9-point lead past the midway point of the first half here with the Garden. With Indiana and Pittsburgh still to come in the second game of the Jimmy V Classic tonight. Monroe gave it right back to Vaughn. Butler bench wanted to travel. They don't get the call, but they will get the ball back.
Tell you right now, you can see the aggressive play, George down the edge.
ESPN is your NBA destination tomorrow night. Derrick Rose and the Bulls take on Joe Johnson, Josh Smith, and the high-flying Atlanta Hawks. That is quickly becoming a contender in the Eastern Conference. It'll be the Bulls and Hawks tomorrow night, 7 Eastern, on ESPN and ESPN HD.
We had some great young players in the Jimmy V 2 years ago. We had O.J. Mayo and Derrick Rose. Yes. Can John Wall be the coming of another Derrick Rose? He's got better quickness than Derrick. Better quickness.
And that's saying something.
Oh, he's quick as can be.
Hayward for three, and the Bulldogs desperately needed that.
See, that's what will get him back in the game. You make some threes, it gives you momentum, plus it gives you points.
That doesn't hurt.
Huh? He gives you three, a nice pass. Great cut without the ball.
Jason Clark lays it in.
Did you see that pass?
Yeah, Greg Monroe. That's what we talked about, him being a facilitator up above the three-point line sometimes.
Please don't use the word facilitator. Okay? Right. That's, we'll define facilitator.
Right. He passes the ball well.
I like that. I like that. Now you're speaking my language,
he gets
bro.
Other people involved.
Hey, man, you're speaking my language.
He makes it easier on his teammates. How about that?
I like that. See, you're from Canada. You speak those big words.
On with the reverse, no good. Here come the Hoyas looking to push it. Knocked out of bounds by Hayward to take us to a timeout. Well, whatever you want to call it, Dick, I know you had to love that last pass.
Oh, absolutely.
Monroe.
Great movement without the ball. That's a lost art. I love kids that move without the basketball.
There's Big John. John Thompson II, who is here, watching his son coach the Georgetown Hoyas, what a run he had for 27 years, national championship in 1984, put that program on the map.
I tell you one thing, this place was rocking when John Wooden would walk in, Louis Carter II would come in with the sweater, St. John's, Georgetown. I will never forget a Big East championship game I did. Talk about a great moment. Iverson against Ray Allen, and Ray Allen scores at the end to win it, and he was not a happy man, Mr. Thompson, that night.
Saw him sitting before the game with Patrick Ewing Jr., the son of the former, of course, great Georgetown legend who played played his pro career right here in this building as well, starting for the New York Knicks.
Right now, Patrick had knee surgery, so he's going to be out of action.
Butler trying to have a go without Matt Howard, one of their stars, on the bench with two fouls. Thompson misses the three. Rebound of Beasley, who can really get up there, but here comes Hayward.
Hey, Georgetown has really dominated inside. 15 rebounds to 5, 12 points in the paint versus only 4 with Butler. Hey, Doris, what about their style of play?
Well, Dick, the movement that you were so happy about on this last play where Greg Monroe has a little backdoor cut by Jason Clark. John Thompson III said, our cuts are as effective as drives. It's a system predicated on reads and reacts, the kinds of plays you get excited about.
I'll tell you one thing. He learned that playing for Peter Correll. When he played at Princeton, he learned all those cuts. Hey, Dan, are you really? There's 16 unbeaten teams, and John Thompson has one of them. 5 in the Big East. Syracuse, Villanova, Seton Hall, and West Virginia, and Georgetown.
West Virginia, I mean, they're ranked in the top 10, but I don't know how many people have seen them yet or realize how good they are. Deshaun Butler, Devin Ebanks, and others. That's a terrific team that Bob Huggins has.
A little zone right now. I don't think you can zone them. I don't think you can zone this team. You got to come out of the zone, man. You can't zone this club.
They don't play much of it. They worked on it for just a few minutes at shoot-around this morning, and we asked John Thompson, are you going to play some? He said, we'll start with man, but we want to have it in our playbook just in case we need it. But you might be right. Butler shoots the ball very well.
Take it out of the playbook right now for this game. Take it out of the playbook for this game.
A travel turns it back over to the Bulldogs. Butler knocking down their 4-3 of the night last time down.
Wide open, there's the line, and this kid can shoot the three. You got to find them. Hey, tomorrow we'll see an unbeaten team, Kentucky. And in Florida, Thursday night, play Syracuse over in Tampa.
Florida's off to a good start.
Oh, that's going to be a great game.
Syracuse, of course, has looked as impressive as any team in the country so far. Almost stolen away by Wright. Jukes runs it down. Looking for the open man, Beasley.
Oh, great open pass.
Hahn misses the three. Weak side rebound, Hayward, and they'll reset.
I mean, Hayward does it all.
Look at the drive by Beasley, and a foul on the Hoyas.
Beasley does a great job attacking the basket. He really does a super job. He's always struggled a little bit on the free throw line, Dan.
Skills of Gordon Hayward. We've seen him distribute the ball. We've seen him shoot the ball. Now we see a great rebound.
Well, he really is multi-dimensional. We use that word. He really fits that goal.
Beasley at the line, 61% on the season. That's getting the bounce.
Tell you one thing's amazing with Beasley. When I looked at this stat, I couldn't believe it. Didn't shoot a three his first 2 years as a player.
Not one.
And his third year, last year, he made 34 of them.
Yep.
He didn't shoot one. I mean, that's unbelievable for a guy his size.
He's listed at 6'3". He's really 6'2", and he's really a forward. Although he's got the height of a guard, he really plays more like a forward, as Jukes, I believe, just got called for the foul. His third, and Jukes came into the game because Matt Howard was on the bench in foul trouble. So Butler's depth in the front court is being tested right now. And to the next whistle, Brad Stevens will make another move and bring in Garrett Butcher, a sophomore out of Ellettsville, Indiana.
You know, a typical game. This game will go into the high 50s probably at the best, maybe early 60s. And that's the style that Butler plays at.
Monroe, no. Beasley.
Nice pass. Great look.
Hollis Thompson lays it in. You never want to save it near your own basket, right?
Exactly. You save it under there, you're looking for trouble. You know, Thompson, an interesting story. He went to Georgetown, gave up his last year in terms of schooling as a senior in high school, and went over for his 1 year and worked out regularly with the team and all while he sat out.
Well, he graduated in January, yeah. So he graduated a half year early. And Thompson went to campus, enrolled in school, and as you say, practiced for 3 months with the Hoyas. It doesn't cost him any eligibility, but he knows the system that John Thompson's put in.
Well, you're giving up a lot when you do that. You're giving up the senior prom. Yeah, you're giving up a lot of great moments. Plus, he gave up to Shia One Selfish playing on all those All-Stars games.
That's right.
But you know, a lot of football players do that. Jimmy Clausen did that up in Notre Dame.
What a steal.
Down, too.
Zach Hahn with a great play. He's got help. Van Zandt back to Hahn. And he knocks down the eight-footer.
Hahn has been a big lift off the bench, doing exactly what our scouting report said. Stroke the basketball. He can shoot the rock, baby. John Stokes, the rock, using it here. He can shoot the rock.
Butler dealing with some foul trouble, trying to stay close until they can get it to halftime.
How big time is that move? That's agile. That's mobile. That brings a smile to Big John's face. I mean, the big fella inside demonstrating that good mobility. Take it down here. That's been the advantage so far in this game. The interior attack of the Hoyas. As Monroe showing that great ability. You know, he could have come out last year. If he really wanted to come out, he would have went high because he would have went, and a magical word, potential. The same with Davis. But they love college and really came back because they want to get stronger physically. He's got a little bit stronger than he was last year.
And he could have been a lottery pick last year, and he'll probably be a lottery pick if he comes out this year. But he's come back for his sophomore season. 30-second timeout taken by Butler. Brad Stevens doesn't want to let it slip away. But one thing that Butler's done well, one of the things that's kept them in this game, is they have made the most of points off turnovers so far tonight. And here's a great steal.
Look at this. Take a look at him right here. There's, look at number three. I mean, right here. Freeze that, baby. Freeze it. Oh, my man. Nice look. There he is for the open jumper. Hit baseline. Jump shot. He can shoot the ball. He really can. They're going to get him more looks. But Hayward's got to be a little bit more aggressive offensively.
7-point lead for the Hoyas. 4:25 to go in the first half here with the Garden. Well, tomorrow night, more great college basketball comes your way. It's the DirecTV SEC Big East Invitational. Georgia and St. John's in the first game, 7 Eastern, over on ESPN2. And then here on ESPN at 9:30. Is this going to be any fun? Kentucky and Connecticut. And the action continues, as you talked about, Dick. Thursday night down in Tampa, it'll be DePaul and Mississippi State in the first game. And then a highly anticipated matchup between Syracuse and Florida in the second game.
Well, my son-in-law is going in a game. He and a bunch of friends. It's going to be a good one. Billy Donovan's got himself a real good, strong basketball team this year.
Beasley spinning. And just too much size for the Hoyas. That was Vaughn coming up with a block. But Butler will keep the ball. Shot clock didn't reset.
I think Vaughn's really giving him a lift. He really is a different player from last year. Took a while to get adjusted to the system. Here he is rotating over. Gives him that great size, the length.
He blocked that with his forearm. Did he even block it with his hand?
Played at Florida State. Florida State's got some size, man. Yeah. We think of Allaby and Gibson and Singleton.
They'll make some noise in the ACC this year.
Well, they'll win some games. Yeah. They find a way to lose some they shouldn't lose.
Pressure defensively by the Hoyas. They really pride themselves on their defense. As you mentioned, they haven't played the toughest schedule so far, but good numbers. Shot clock's at one. And that'll be Georgetown ball on the shot clock violation.
You know, Butler now takes everybody's best hit.
Coming up on the UPS halftime report. There they are, John Saunders, Digger Phelps, Jay Billis, Bob Knight. A look back at what's happened so far on the young season of college basketball. Should the tournament be expanded up to as many as 96 teams? And a look
at the number four
moment in college basketball history.
Oh, look at
Madison Square Garden. Well, on this day, it's going back a couple of years, but on this day back in 1965, Bob Knight picked up the first of 902 wins as he beat Worcester Tech.
You tell the general right now, I'm giving him 901. Worcester Tech? I didn't even know they had a basketball team. He's taking credit for that?
Excuse me.
Hey, you can't give him a win against Worcester Tech.
Excuse me. When you coached at the University of Detroit,
I want to roll Worcester
Tech. You might have played a Worcester or two.
I want to roll Worcester Tech, man. Bring them on down.
They all count, Dick. You know that.
I told our people one time we're playing St. John's.
Look at this. Monroe driving to the bucket for two more.
It's Monroe. I told our people playing St. John's. We were. I forgot to put on the schedule now. St. John's, Minnesota. I thought Gordon Hayward was coming.
And did you win that one?
Oh, yeah.
Are you giving it back?
No.
No.
I didn't get that minute.
The Hoyas up by 9 late in the first half. Butler with some foul trouble as Brad Stevens has now brought in Andrew Smith, a true freshman, a 6'11 out of Indianapolis. So, Coach Stevens, he was 33 at the start of the game. Does he look a little bit older to you right now?
I'm gonna tell you why. He looks about 12 to me. He looks great. But you know the key in this game? They have shut down Mack. Mack's averaging 15 points a game. He's only got 3. They need Mack to put some points on the board.
That's him with the ball right now. Uses the shot fake. Gets by Monroe. Left the jumper short. And look at Clark hit the floor. He just got there quicker than anybody else, but Butler recovers it at least to get a held ball, and the arrow will keep it with them. We talked a little bit about Georgetown defense, not just a this year thing. They've been good for a long time.
Oh, absolutely. That was one of the trademarks when you talk about Georgetown in basketball. It's always been about defense. They really take great pride. I remember the John Thompson. There were two factors with his game. They defended exceptionally well and offensively rebounded, where they really created havoc on the glass.
Hayward. And the three for Mack. You were talking about it. That's the guy they needed to get going, and he knocks down the tray.
You know, he played, as you said earlier, on the gold medal championship team. He's a very talented player. Came out of Bryant Station High School in Lexington, where they had a player played at Kentucky one time, and the Melvin Turpin.
Look at Andy Katz getting into the game.
Oh, I want the ball, baby. Yeah. Look at the rock. I got the rock. I got the rock. Come on.
You did a better job than Katz did down there.
So he had
a turnover on Katz.
Krulowitz. Yeah. Krulowitz. That's the PR director, Josh, sitting next to Katz. They're getting some PR. Schwabi. Go get some knee, Schwabi.
Meanwhile, Butler's got it back within 6. Let's see if they can keep it going.
That's that 3. That's what the 3 will do for you. They're good balance, good spacing. They really space exceptionally well, as Bob Knight would say, 15 to 17 feet apart, so you can't give help.
And the third foul on Hollis Thompson of Georgetown.
You know, I was on Mike and Mike this morning, and I love those guys. We have a lot of fun, and we were talking today about the expansion of the tournament. I just don't believe that should happen. I know there are a lot of guys that believe it. Some say even 128. I think we got ourselves a great product right now. Why water it down and expand it? So I would say emphatically N-O to expansion. I know coaches would like it because, number one, it creates more job situations of security.
Now, part of the story, or at least the rumor, is that if they expanded the NCAA, it might swallow up or eliminate the NIT. So then you'd have, say, 96 in the NCAA instead of 65 in the NCAA plus the NIT. Does that change your mind at all?
No, not at all. I'm going to tell you right now. I think the current rate is phenomenal. I even liked it when it was earlier. But the best of the best, man, you got to earn the right to play in the tournament. That's what it's supposed to be about, reward for playing well.
Monroe looked like he might have lost it just a little bit on the way up. Otherwise, he had an easy 2.
I think we got too many bowl games right now. You got every bowl imaginable. Some of those teams that are getting bowls should be in the toilet bowl. Are you kidding me?
That
should be in the toilet bowl.
That's Jason Clark again knocking the ball out of bounds. And there's Dan Guerrero, the chairman of the NCAA selection committee. I don't know if he can hear you right now, but this is something apparently that the committee is actively considering.
Well, they're not going to listen to me, so that means it's going to happen.
Boy, that's Clark again, reaching around from behind and knocking it out of bounds. He is a menace defensively.
Yeah, but he's got those long arms. Yeah. He's got the great reach.
He's 6'2", but as we mentioned earlier, they say that his arms are the length of a guy who would be about 6'7". Nice bounce pass into the corner.
Yes, such great feel for the game, Hayward. He really is thinking ahead all the time.
Another block.
He's not a reactor. He's an anticipator. By the head Monroe. Total mismatch inside. Should have thrown it up high. There it is. A little bit too late.
And a foul before the shot.
You know, recognition is so important for people to recognize when to make the entry to the post. We're going to watch Monroe's presence right here. I mean, look at that presence. Shot blocker, let him in block shots last year. Came the way of New Orleans. I still love watching Patrick Ewing and Alonzo. How much did I love him? In my book, the best 50 players in the last 30 years. And by the way, if anybody would like a copy, go to my website. All my dollars from that book are going to go to the V Foundation toward a $1 million research grant that I'm trying to raise for pediatric cancer. But Patrick was number one. I'm not going to say it was number two, number three. You're going to buy the book. But Patrick was number one.
Well, there's a guy who knows a little bit about his dad. There's Patrick Ewing Jr., played for both Indiana, we'll see in the second game tonight, and Georgetown.
Well, yeah, played at Indiana and Georgetown, so he's here to see both clubs. Georgetown will also transfer Mr. Rivers.
Jeremiah Rivers, yeah,
yeah. Jeremiah, Doc Rivers' son, playing for Indiana.
He's the starting point guard for the Hoosiers, who we'll see after this game tonight against Pittsburgh. Tom Crean now in his second year. Major rebuilding project at Indiana, but without question a more talented team this year than they were a year ago.
I think there's no doubt in my mind. Another 3 years, you're going to see Indiana where they belong, in the top 20 every year. Bob Mack was there. They were constantly up there.
Mack with the foul after V. Sanford reached in and caused the turnover. And Georgetown really getting disruptive defensively, really bothering the Bulldogs.
Yeah, really bothering right there. And that's like a four-point turnaround, because you got the basketball, got a chance to cut this to four. Instead, right now, that play is going to put them on a free throw line. They can go up to eight.
So the foul on Mack, his second. At the free throw line is Sanford, a freshman out of Lexington, Kentucky, only getting about 7 minutes per game.
You know, we know about certainly the Big East, but the Horizon has some good basketball. Especially you go on a road there, Wright State with Brad Brunell. They have a good basketball team. Gary Waters did a great job last year. When you think about, for example, right now, the Cleveland State Vikings. They've got some good basketball. John LaCroix in the house, the commissioner of the conference. Detroit, my former school, they're 6-2 right now.
A conference that, generally speaking, gets multiple bids into the NCAA tournament. But Butler kind of is to the Horizon League what Gonzaga is to the West Coast Conference. They're kind of the king of that league right now, the team that everybody's trying to knock off. And this is a Butler team with every player back from a 26-win team a year ago. Terrific drive by Beasley.
Hey, Beasley shows that ability to get to the rack. Does a great job protecting the basketball. You mentioned Detroit, the Titans. Raymond Talley's son is one of the top players in the country, high school.
Nice soft touch by the big man, Greg Monroe, who's having himself some kind of a game.
Too unselfish, my friends. That guy is so talented. He should take 18 to 20 shots a game.
How about 12 points and 6 rebounds in the first half for Monroe? Remember, Matt Howard, who would be playing against him, is on the bench and has been for about 8 minutes with foul trouble.
Monroe can play all over the court with his quickness.
Final seconds here of the first half. Mack gets it to go. Georgetown with time to get a last shot off.
So Sheldon Mack stepping it up a little. They're going to need that. Oh, great look inside. Great look inside. That's good basketball IQ. Clark with the great lob up to Mr. Monroe. Yes, sir. Just a terrific play right there. Great two-man basketball. Look at the points of the paint. Domination. Domination by the Hoyas.
And a huge first half for Greg Monroe, getting it done in so many different ways, and the biggest reason why Georgetown has an 8-point lead. Butler coach Brad Stevens is with Doris Burke.
Yeah, Dan, a huge disparity in the paint. How do you deal with them inside?
Well, I think one of the things we have to do is get Avery and Matt back in the game. I mean, Matt Howard's been out since the 10-minute mark. Avery Jukes has 3 fouls, and we just have to be a little bit better there. I mean, we ended the half with two, basically, guards guarding their posts, and you know what? We got in, and it's still an 8-point game, and there's a lot of possessions left, so if we play a little bit better and we keep those guys in the game, move the ball, I don't think we're in awful shape.
Coach, thank you. Dan.
All right, Doris, thank you. At the half, Georgetown 39 to Butler 31. Greg Monroe, the biggest reason. After the break, it's John Saunders, Digger Phelps, Jay Billis, and Bob Knight.
The 2009 Jimmy V Classic is brought to you by...
Welcome back to Madison Square Garden in New York City. Game one of the Jimmy V Classic. Georgetown and Butler, an 8-point lead for the Hoyas as we go to the second half. A very, very impressive first half for Greg Monroe, the multidimensional talent for Georgetown. And he was a big reason why the Hoyas have the lead. They shot well. Rebounding was huge. Points in the paint, huge. They really dominated. Dick, with their size on the inside of Monroe, was terrific.
Yeah, he was the difference maker. He was the dominator on the interior. He was so agile inside. They couldn't handle him. They had Howard out of the game with his fouls. Look at his quickness around the basket. There's the reverse layup. very agile, as I said earlier. He's exploded to the basket. So skilled, good touch. He was brilliant. But also, don't forget, as you watch him operate on the inside, he got that pass from Clark. Clark was big at 9 points, gave him great defense, and did a super job out at the perimeter for Georgetown.
What does Butler need to do to get back in it?
I think they're going to make threes, and they got to get some scoring inside out of Howard. He's got to become really a factor. The big three, Hayward, Howard, and Mack, have to really take charge to get them to the victor circle.
Well, Howard picked up his second foul less than 10 minutes into the game, did not return. So Butler, even with one of their best players on the bench for more than 10 minutes, stayed within eight. And as Brad Stevenson endorsed on his way off the court at the end of the first half, we're not in awful position. That's about as far as he was willing to go. And there's an early turnover on the Hoyas. Let's check in now with Doris.
Well, Dick just said it. Butler's got to make threes for John Thompson III. I said, what's your biggest concern? He said, listen, they made five threes, and they missed some open threes that they normally make. He said, we've got to be solid with our rotations and our effort defensively and make sure we prevent that, guys.
I tell you one thing, Doris, perimeter defense against the Butler team is really essential. But they got no answer for him inside. Yeah. No answer at all for Monroe. I don't think many teams have an answer for him.
16 for Greg Monroe. That's the biggest lead of the night for Georgetown.
This is the kind of game you expect out of him with that talent. You really do.
Beasley misses an open shot. And over the back, Julian Devon for the foul. Doris talked about it. Butler is generally considered to be a really terrific shooting team, but so far this year, for the most part, and so far tonight, they're missing open shots.
Yeah, they really shot well against Valpo, against Homa Drew's club. That was the one game, the last one, but six games in a row, they were away from home. They struggled shooting the basketball.
This is the ninth game of the year for Butler. They've only played two of them at home. They'll play a lot of tough teams, and sometimes they'll have to go to their court or play neutral side games in order to get those games. There's another rebound by Monroe.
They're like Gonzaga, man. They'll play you any place, anytime, anywhere. Davidson as well. You think about McKillop, what he did when he had Curry?
Butler's got the home games you talked about, Ohio State and Xavier coming up. They've got a bracket buster game. They've already played Minnesota, UCLA, and Clemson, so they're trying to load up that schedule. Mack, too strong on the three.
Get one shot, can't get any seconds. Nice spin.
Back then a pass. Turnover by Wright. And great hustle by Freeman to steal it right back.
Got a little turnover city. You turn it over, I turn it over. I can turn it over better than you can turn it over.
8 turnovers committed by Butler, 11 turnovers committed by Georgetown.
Get the ball in the hands of Monroe. Good things happen. Get him the ball inside. Hayward playing right now.
And Clark fouled on the drive. A great burst of speed there by Jason Clark.
I tell you, he's really going to be adding a nice dimension to this club. You see, he's gotten better another year. He's a South, grew up after his freshman year.
And Dick, less than 2 minutes into the half, Matt Howard just picked up his third
foul.
Was
that Howard that got the third there? I thought they had it earlier. Oh, they got the foul of the guy stepping in the secondary defender. I tell you what, you're going to start aging. Hey, Brad, you're going to start aging. Do you know he worked at Eli Lilly? He was a marketing individual in the marketing department and all of a sudden joined the staff as a volunteer assistant.
Yep.
And then for 6 years, when that model left, he became an assistant to Licklider, got the job, and, you know, he's one of the three fastest to get to the 50 mark in the country.
An economics major, he's very into the numbers, and he looks at things like plus minus with each player on the floor, the opponent's field goal percentage with each player on the floor, trying to go a little bit deeper into the stats to see what's really meaningful and who's really helping his team.
Were you there 1915 when Coach Mayfield did it?
I don't know.
At Wisconsin?
No.
Yeah, you were there then. 1915, you weren't there? Bill Carmody did it at Princeton. Bill Carmody did it, doing a great job this year at Northwestern.
Well, I'll tell you what, Brad Stevens at shoot-around today. Remember, this is an Indiana boy. This is a kid who grew up in the state of Indiana. He walked in for shoot-around today, and who was sitting in the third row watching? Coach Knight from Bloomington and Coach Phelps from South Bend. And Brad Stevens said, hey, for a kid who grew up in Indiana, that's pretty big, meeting Bob Knight and Digger Phelps.
Wow, not bad. Well, meeting Bob Knight, I know, is really, really big. He met Mr. Digger Phelps as well.
What are you leaving Digger out? Austin Freeman picked up the foul, his third. Howard stays in the game with 3 fouls, working hard, but can't finish.
He's got to stay in the game. He's got to stay in the game, and I would attack him right now. As you said, he has a habit of, he fouled out already, won 4 games this year.
Matt Howard still hasn't made a field goal in this game.
Matt is big. He's player of the year last year in the conference.
Look at Monroe for 3. Around and out. Vaughn with a terrific rebound in traffic, but now called for the offensive foul.
He was MVP in the conference when you talk about Howard. Preseason picked his player of the year in the conference.
It was Nick Rogers, a walk-on, who checked into the game, taking the charge. He'll come out now. Zach Hahn comes back in. But maybe Brad Stevens trying to mix it up a little bit, give him a bit of a spark. And you talked about his record. His third year now as the head coach at Butler, off to one of the fastest starts of any head coach in college basketball. Just a terrific winning percentage.
You know, he had a 31-5 record in his first 2 years in the Horizon Conference. Pretty good.
There's a bounce they needed as the jumper goes down for Hayward.
They're going to get more looks for Hayward. Hayward's got to get his hands on the basketball and think offense rather than think a pass.
Howard almost reached in there and picked up his fourth. He's got to be awfully careful.
See, they're trying to attack him right now. Trying to take the ball. That's smart. That's cerebral. That's really playing the game with your head. That's why they go to Georgetown anyway. It's a tough school to get in academically. You better have 1,500 on the SATs.
Well, there's Brad Stevens. I bet you he did pretty well on his SATs. Look at him, 62-12.
Wow.
Entering his 75th career game, which is tonight. How he compares with some other great, now Hall of Fame coaches in their first 75 games.
Play this kind of competition is really good for them. Once they get conference play, they're going to dominate again.
And Vaughn with the foul on the move by Howard.
And they're always a dangerous team come tournament time. Play them in a shorty, you got to be concerned because they're going to always be in a game. They have a way of controlling tempo of a game.
Last year, they were a young team as Vaughn picks up his third and heads to the bench. Hollis Thompson back in. Last year, Butler was a young team. They had lost four starters, but they did make the tournament, lost in the first round to LSU. But with everybody back this year, Butler was ranked preseason for the first time ever. Not only ranked, ranked 10th as Georgetown goes zone again, and Howard misses near the rim again.
I tell you, he's psychologically was thinking about the big guy coming over the block to shot Monroe. He was anticipating him.
The size has really bothered him tonight. Howard is 0-6 from the field.
When you got the player of the year in the conference going 0-6 and you're playing a team the quality of Georgetown undefeated, you're in trouble. I mean, you got to have your stars respond in a big moment.
Monroe the kick, Freeman the three from the corner. Third three of the night for Austin Freeman.
Monroe gets a lot of attention, kicks the ball in and out. Just a good inside-outside action.
And the lead has gone from 8 to 13 here in the first 4.5 minutes of the second half.
Very dangerous time right now. Very dangerous time for Butler.
Mack. Norred, not a score, passed it up. Hayward jams it.
He's a big timer. He is a big timer. Homer Drew said it best. After they lost to him, he said three letters define what this kid's about. NBA.
And he's just a sophomore. Still growing. Grew an inch between his freshman season and this year. He's now 6'9".
He must have had some serve. They said he finished in the top 8 in high school in the state of Indiana as a tennis player.
Freeman again. His fourth three of the game.
That's big. Freeman knocking down those trifectas. And it's supposed to be the weapon of Butler, but it's the weapon of the Hoyas. This Hoyas team is better than the team we saw last year.
Austin Freeman had made 6 threes in the first 6 games Georgetown had played in. He has made 4 already here tonight, and the Hoyas have their largest lead of the night. Story and his legacy, his memory lives on the Jimmy V Foundation at 1-800-4-JIMMY-V, jimmyv.org. You have done more than your part over the years. Your gala down in Sarasota, you can go to dickvitaleonline.com to get tickets this upcoming May the 21st down in beautiful Sarasota. The guests of honor, Tony Dungy, Tom Izzo, a ton of money raised in this event over the years. I've been there a couple of times. It's great. And you get a big announcement for 2011.
Well, I'm so excited. I can't believe it. I'm excited about Dungy and Izzo. We're going to sell it out. So you better get your tickets and raise $1 million for pediatric cancer. 2011, ready for this? The winningest programs, North Carolina and Kentucky. We're going to honor Calipari and Roy Williams. They're both confirmed with me. They'll be there May 20th, 2011. We'll have over 50 coaches there for Dungy and Izzo, and it's going to be a great, great night.
It's a terrific night, a terrific weekend. Look at Greg Monroe. Is there anything he hasn't done in this game?
John Stondos will be our host. We'll have all kinds of celebrities with us. The Ritz-Carlton, the beautiful Ritz in Sarasota.
Monroe turns and faces on Howard. Howard playing with three, remember. Monroe just kind of threw it off the glass, and the rebound comes down to Butler. Butler needs a spark. They need to find something at the offensive end.
I think psychologically they're really hurting because their star hasn't been able to score on the inside. He's 0 for 6 right now. There's Brick City, USA, for a guy that was MVP of the league, Mr. Howard. He's got to forget the fouls and score. They're trying to get it inside to him.
Hayward's nice pass. Look. Beasley in the corner.
He can really pass the ball.
It'll be Georgetown ball. Timeout on the floor here for the first game of two from the Jimmy B Classic. In game two, it'll be Pittsburgh taking on the Indiana Hoosiers. Tom Crean and the Hoosiers are on their way in.
He's probably talking to some recruits. He's talking to some recruits.
$1 has been raised for the V Foundation. Pick up the phone, 1-800-4-JIMMY-V. Go online at jimmyv.org. Every dollar you donate goes directly to cancer research. Georgetown by 14 over Butler. Here in the second half, Dan Schulman, Dick Vitale, Doris Burke, also John Saunders, Bob Knight, Digger Phelps, Jay Billis with us as well. Here for the Jimmy V Classic in New York. Hollis Thompson rattles it home.
You know, Thompson shows a lot of skills. He's a young kid just getting familiar with their system. Came by the way of California, high school star out there.
Georgetown's lost a couple of players from last year. Seniors DeJuan Summers, Jesse Sapp. But it looks like a lot of the players that they still have, Dick, are noticeably improved from a year ago.
Absolutely. I think familiarity with the system, getting to understand it. Lost a couple of transfers, by the way. Rivers will be playing in the next game. Also, Macklin, who's playing really well for the University of Florida.
That foul on Hollis Thompson, his fourth. He's going to have to sit down as Henry Sims will come back in.
Ted, they've been very impressive here tonight. Yep. Their execution, very efficient with the basketball. You're talking about a struggle, man. This kid is absolutely struggling.
He has just had his hands full and then some with Greg Monroe tonight. Thompson out, as mentioned, Sims in. Monroe and Sims just bigger and stronger than Matt Howard. He's just running into too much size, too many bodies on the inside.
A lot of quickness as well. You know, Howard and Matt come in a game averaging 27 points per game. Tonight they got a total of 10. And you look at the difference on the game, that's quite a bit. Now it's up to 11.
Monroe, the lefty, leaves it a little bit short. Howard, a good defense, and he's got the rebound.
They got to go on a real spurt shooting threes, but Georgetown's right up in the face of the perimeter. Look how they're extending their defense. They're saying, you're going to bounce it and go to the basket.
Hayward, a great feed. Howard, again, misses inside. Monroe just picked up rebound number 10, his seventh career double-double. Freeman. It'll be a held ball. It'll be Butler ball.
Showing you how effective Howard is. I mean, today's having a bad day, but usually he's so effective. One game he went 14 for 15 on the free throw line. Look at him missing on the inside. Here he is, nothing falling for him. Another game he went 13 for 14 on the free throw line. I mean, he usually gets to the line. Can't get any conversions. Can't score on the inside. That's a big, big plus for Georgetown that they've shut him down.
And he has such a look of frustration on his face as he goes up and down the court. Has not made a field goal tonight. Foul trouble tonight. Foul trouble in a number of other games this year.
I think the MVP in that league, when it's all said and done, come and see me. Gold trophy, going to go to a kid by the name of Hayward when it's all said and done.
Yeah, Gordon Hayward, looks like the sky is the limit for him. Number 20 just made that pass.
He just understands how to play, too.
And finally, Matt Howard gets one to go. First field goal of the night.
And that's where he usually is effective, right in the low box. He's got a lot of unique movements down inside, scores effectively. Maybe that'll give him the momentum now. May Uncle Mo be on his side.
Still plenty of time, better than 12 minutes. They're down 14. Clark, no, and over the back, Julian Vaughn called for the foul. Number four on Vaughn, the second Hoya already to pick up four fouls tonight.
I tell you one thing, what they need to get a little spurt, they got to find a way to make some open trifectas, and that would give them a spurt. But John Thompson's done a great job with his game plan as the architect of their defense, building their defense to shut the three down.
Let's check in with Doris Burke.
Now, John Thompson III will tell you that a year older, more experienced team is better prepared. But one of the things he criticized about his team last year is he said, we played very good basketball for 32 minutes on very many nights, but it wasn't enough. We'll see here down the stretch if it's enough, guys.
Oh, what a great block right there. They're going to try to get it down to 10 going in the last 10 minutes.
That was Monroe again with a block. Clark misses the three. Hahn had it knocked away. And a foul called on Butler. It'll be Grant Leyendecker, number 22. Call for the foul. Timeout on the floor. The Greg Monroe story just keeps rolling on here.
Well, watch him rotate over. See with the left hand. With the left hand. Usually the best shot blocker with the righty shooting.
Importantly, Georgetown, Greg Monroe, outstanding tonight. Dick, take us inside the play.
Well, watch right here. We're going to see a little screen come up on top. Here's Howard with the screen, but keep an eye on this guy here, how he rotates into this area defensively. We're going to see the screen. Now take a look right here. Freeze it. Right here. Watch this. He's already smelling the possibility of a block shot. He's smelling it. There he is rotating over, and there's the great timing for the block shot, and so effective with the left hand. You think about Bill Russell, you think about David Robinson, great shot blockers utilizing the left hand against the majority of shooters who are righties.
Well, you just can't teach some of the skills that Greg Monroe has. 16 points, 10 rebounds, 2 blocks, 2 assists tonight. More than just a facilitator tonight, huh, Dick?
I'll tell you one thing, he's got to get himself just a little bit more hungry. Tonight we're seeing that. He's going to do that on a regular basis.
Freeman's first miss from beyond the arc tonight. Now 4 for 5 from 3, 5 for 6 overall.
See, I think Howard's feeling it now. I'll get the ball inside to Howard. I'll dump it into the post.
Hahn for 3.
Shot that too quickly. Didn't really have the open 3. He's a good long-range shooter.
And here comes Monroe, act as a passer.
And he's such a good passer. He's probably as good a passer you'll find in America for a big play.
Clark, a deep 3. Ooh. 2 players hit the floor hard, and then Chris Wright is called for a foul. Sims and Howard both hitting the deck hard, but both appear to be okay.
Hoyas still undefeated. Look at the hustle here, the scrap, the claw. Hoyas one of 16 teams, unblemished. Tell you one thing, we got a little Bob Knight influence. New Mexico's undefeated. Texas Tech is undefeated. His son, Patrick.
What a win for them,
Steve
over
Alford.
Washington in overtime.
Yeah, you think about, hey, what about Missouri State? They're undefeated. And the reason I mention them, former Purdue great, Lonzo Martin, the coach, is a cancer survivor. And they're undefeated in the Missouri Valley, along with Illinois State. UTEP is undefeated, feeling the effects of John Calipari.
Dick, that foul on Wright was the 7th team foul on Georgetown already. 1-1 for Butler. Free throws the rest of the way as Hayward knocks down a pair.
I got a feeling we're going to see a little spurt coming on by Butler. I don't think this game is over yet. Some people might say, well, complete command, control, especially the domination of number 10, Monroe. I see a little spurt coming on by this club.
That's Sims, I believe, called for the foul. Number 3 on him. More college basketball comes your way tomorrow night. It's the DirecTV SEC Big East Invitational.
Wow.
Begins at 7 Eastern over on ESPN2.
Wow.
Georgia and St. John's. And then the big one at 9:30 Eastern here on ESPN. Kentucky and Connecticut. Calipari, Calhoun, John Wall, the phenomenal freshman for the Wildcats. It's going to be fun here in the Garden.
I can't wait. I'm going to sit in the sea with you.
Yeah.
I'm going to sit here and see John Wall and see Connecticut. Tyson and Walker, the great backcourt. They're going to have the points on the board against the Cats of Kentucky.
Another missed opportunity by Butler at one end, and a bad turnover by Georgetown at this end. Well, look quickly because he's a blur. John Wall, the outstanding freshman for Kentucky we talked about. We're going to see him tomorrow night as fast end-to-end as anybody in America.
Yeah, that type of dent, he can flat-out play. Look at that quickness, the explode. Look at that acrobatic. Are you kidding me, that shot? He wants 3 for that, baby. Degree of difficulty.
In his first game against Miami of Ohio, hit the winning shot with less than a second to go. Played very well against Carolina despite missing 8 minutes of the game because of cramps. But look at how many good opportunities they're missing. Finally, the putback is good. And maybe here comes that little spurt you're talking about. It's down to 10.
You can see the focus in their eyes, the clapping their hands, the defense a little more effective. They're zoning now. They're zoning.
Avery Jukes called for the foul.
Been a little matchup zone here. Gonna make them make some free throws.
Number 4 on Jukes. Doris talked about it. JT3, John Thompson, the head coach of Georgetown, talked about how often they would play 32 minutes but not 40 minutes, and they let a lot of leads slip away last year. It's down to 10 right now, and they've still got plenty of time.
They really did. I mean, last year they had some magical wins and then turned around and had some bad losses.
Finished 16 and 15, knocked out of the first round of the NIT.
7-11 in the conference play. That conference was a monster. You take the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame and Georgetown last year, put them in other conferences, they'd probably be in the top 3.
And those were teams that a lot of people thought had top 10 potential nationally at the beginning of the season, didn't even make the NCAA tournament. Now, Michael Stevens, one of the officials, he stopped play. And I don't know if we have a shot clock issue, perhaps. They're going over and looking at the monitor. They have reset it from 19 to 26.
Hey, John Thompson III has been around some really great basketball people. Pete Carell and his dad. His dad had a way. If you define coaching, the ability to get the most out of people, that was his great strength, to get people to play hard with intensity, emotion.
Good defense by Howard. Butler's got it.
It's that spurt. They got numbers.
Van Zandt.
Oh, got numbers. Should have given it up to Hayward. Not a good play. Now look at the layup the other way. A four-point turnaround with the jam. A four-point turnaround. You got numbers. You got to convert there.
Butler bench was screaming for a foul. Didn't get the call. Monroe the slam at the other end.
Didn't make a good decision. You had to give the ball up to Hayward. They give the rock up to Hayward there. They score. I mean, look at that turnaround. Four-point turnaround. Instead of being eight down, they're down 12. You got to score it. You had Hayward. You just throw a little hook pass to Hayward, and you got a deuce. And there's the jam. The easiest one he'll get all night. He looks like Dan Schulman with that bounce off the ground. They don't jump like that in Canada. They don't jump like that
they
in Canada.
Don't,
do
no,
they?
Canadians don't jump.
Well, John Saunders could jump.
Yeah.
Country John.
That's right.
He used to be a country guy down there at disco, played all Charlie Pride music.
Henry Sims picks up the foul, his fourth. So if there is a big concern for Georgetown right now, it's the team foul trouble and the fact that Butler's going to be at the line the rest of the way.
Not over. This game is not over. I'm telling you, this game is not over.
And there are three Georgetown players, all big guys, Sims, Vaughn, Thompson, all with four fouls.
You know, as Doris said, they have a tendency to let leads get away last year. Got to learn to focus to play for 40. That's one thing John Thompson II, his team's always played 40, man, 40 minutes. That's what he's trying to establish.
Norrod the foul, his first, team's fourth. Into the game and out for Georgetown, Jarrell Benamon, a freshman out of Warrenton, Virginia. As Sims goes out with four fouls, Benamon's been battling a bad ankle. This is his first action of the night, and he's only in there because of the foul trouble. Monroe becomes that much more important with a lot of the other big guys out right now.
I got to get some touches in the back to Monroe.
Offensive foul, Austin Freeman, his fourth foul. Four Hoyas with four fouls apiece.
Starting to get away from getting the ball into Monroe. Monroe's got to get the touches on the inside. There's Freeman out of control right there, out of control. There's the contact.
18 turnovers now committed by Georgetown. The lead is 10.
There's that screen and roll.
Hayward, a good look for three. Got it!
Tell you one thing, he can play for me any day of the week. Mr. Versatility. And back in the game, baby. Only seven down.
It's a 12-2 run for Butler. Timeout, Georgetown.
Don't you think you're going to lose, Spurt?
You're right.
You feel it in their eyes, man. See it in their eyes.
And foul trouble, really the big story. It's knocked some key guys out of the game for Georgetown, and it's given Butler some free opportunities at the free throw line as well.
I really like Hayward. He's better than advertised. I just think he's got to be a little bit more selfish, want to shoot the ball a little bit more. He's got great touch, shot better than 40% from the three last year. Struggled a little bit this year shooting, but you can see he's got a great stroke.
And he was a big part of that Team USA that won the 19 and under gold medal in New Zealand. He made the all-tournament team. He and his teammate Sheldon Mack were both on that team that brought gold home to the USA.
He's got nine here in the second half. He's very talented, understands, has a great feel we talk about for the game. He has instincts. He anticipates. I heard Bob Knight once give a lecture about anticipating and reacting. You don't want to be a reactor because that's negative. You want to anticipate, and that's what he does.
What Hayward needs, though, Dick, a little bit of help. Howard's starting to pick it up, finally made a field goal. He's gotten himself to the free throw line, but the Bulldogs need more from these two guys.
Yeah, Mack and Howard are star players, and they're going to have to elevate their game right now down the stretch.
Howard has managed to stay on the floor this half. Wright misses the three. What a tap back by Benamon.
I tell you, Benamon gives him a lift right there with that good offensive rebound.
He's a big body, 6'7", 240. John Thompson says once he's completely healthy, he is really going to help.
Oh, he just fouled right there. Hayward, they caught him. Put him away from the ball. No doubt about it.
Another look at the Benamon tip from the other end.
Watch this mysterious hand come out of nowhere. Here comes the mysterious hand. Look, and he tips it. Fingertips. Notice the fingertips. You don't tip with the palm. Nice little fingertips.
The foul on Benamon, the 10th team foul on the Hoyas. Two shots the rest of the way for Butler, and they're a pretty good free throw shooting team. And they've got the right guy in the line in Hayward, 85% on the season.
Yeah, he was better than 80% shooter last year on the free throw line. Such a plus when you guys can make fouls, especially late in the game. It is so important. That's a big edge. I mean, free throw shooting, the edge has got to go to Butler. They're locking up defensively a little bit better, too. Matching up, they're playing that defense. Getting over the top of screens.
Good help by Howard, and another turnover by the Hoyas.
It's close to 20, he has 19 turnovers. Find Hayward, reverse it to Hayward. Get him involved. Oh, he passes too much. He's got to take that shot. He's got to take that shot in the lane.
And Mack is injured behind the play for Butler. Sheldon Mack is down, 5-on-4.
Can't stop the action unless he's in danger himself.
And now with Mack unable to get up in obvious pain, yep, they blow the whistle. This is a key player, one of the so-called big three for the Butler Bulldogs. He is a terrific player.
He's a star player. He can make threes. He can attack the basket. He's very athletic. Let's hope it's not a serious injury. Here he is.
Number one, Mack. Injured on this play.
Boy, no foul there. They got all ball. No foul, no contact.
We'll try to update his status when we come back.
Verizon Wireless, America's most reliable wireless network.
It's always beautiful around the holidays here in New York City. Glad you're with us for the Jimmy V Classic, game one of two, Georgetown and Butler here on ESPN. We just saw an injury to one of the Butler Bulldogs key players, Sheldon Mack. Looks like a right shoulder injury as he gets medical attention on the bench. One more look, Dick.
You know, I thought there was contact there. I thought they could have blown the whistle. Let's take a look right here. What do you say, boy? She got two eyes.
No, it looked like Wright came down on the right arm of Mack, on the right forearm, and may have injured his shoulder in the process.
See, possessions like that become big. Johnny Cal's one of the best officials. He had a good view. He was right there, so I'll give him the benefit of the doubt.
Dorsberg talking to the Butler staff, confirming it is a right shoulder injury as they continue to look at him. Monroe, the key player in this game, the dominant player in this game tonight.
Trying to body up on him, push him out.
Clark tried the backdoor cut, and Butler's got it again. That's another Georgetown turnover.
It's 20 right now.
Yep.
20 turnovers. Wow. That's a lot of turnovers. That's really got to be driving John Thompson a third. Bananas on that sideline.
Turnovers and fouls in the last 6 or 7 minutes, keeping the Bulldogs in this game.
Well, you take away possessions, take away shot attempts.
Air ball by Hayward.
Wow.
The Hoosiers of Indiana and Pittsburgh coming up in our second game tonight. It'll start about 20 minutes after the end of this one right here on ESPN.
Jamie Dixon told me at halftime, he said, we're going to get better. We're getting better and better. We're up 15-7 at half against New Hampshire. I thought it was a football score.
It was 7-7 with 4.5 minutes to go in the half. The lowest scoring first half since the shot clock came into the game.
Shot clock, three-point shot, 15-7. Right now, big possession right here. Go to Howard. Oh, he's wide open. You got to shoot it. Oh, they're going to make that one. He's too good a shooter. Wide open.
Frustration for Hayward, but Butler has gotten back into this game. Georgetown has gone very, very cold offensively, turning the ball over, and it's a 14-4 run right now for Butler. Look at that, 4 points in 7 minutes for the Hoyas.
They went on a real spurt. They've done a better job really right now, Monroe, in the second half. He's got four, and I think one of the reasons is Howard's on the floor. So Howard gives him that big body to match up with him. Remember, he missed the last 10 minutes in the first half.
Has been in the game almost the entire second half. Van Zant goes to the bench. Willie Beasley's back in. Sheldon Mack remains out of the game with a shoulder injury, but he just stood up and is heading down towards his coach. No, just getting a closer seat. Just moving closer to where the coach sits. Maybe trying to get his attention and tell him he can go back in.
Tell you what, they'll need him. He's a veteran player. Oh, that's a great spin move on the baseline. He's got a great spin move down in the post.
Got 20 points tonight. There's your 2010 you were talking
about. Exactly.
And
he's also taking 16 shots, which I really believe he's got to do.
Hayward into traffic, draws the foul. Two more shots coming. Yeah, foul on Chris Wright.
Not only two more shots coming, it stops the clock. It also stops the clock. Watch this quickness in the post. There's that great spin move. He has the great first step. He has that quick, agile first step. Hey, Knicks getting better. Had a nice win last night. A little blowout.
Beat Portland, beat Phoenix a few days ago.
Why would he want to trade Harrington? I see you in the paper that thinking about trading him. He put some points on the board.
Well, Hayward keeps knocking him down from the line. Here comes Clark back into the game for Wright for the Hoyas. Still a long time to go, almost 6 minutes to go in this one.
I tell you, look at Hayward, 6'9", and I'm going to say, I'm not saying he's Larry Bird, because there's only one Larry Bird, but he's a mini, mini version of Larry Bird. He really is, in terms of passing ability, shooting ability. I mean, I want to make this very clear. I'm not saying he's Larry Bird, because there's only one Larry and there's only one matchup.
Well, for a kid who's from the state of Indiana, that's high praise indeed.
But he's a mini version.
Yeah. He's got talent, just a sophomore.
Lots of talent.
Monroe spinning, finds the open man. Benham on the kick to Clark. Lost it, got it back. Still plenty of time. Freeman off the glass. Monroe again.
Tell you what, just dominating. And that's what you expect out of talent. He came out of high school rated the number one high school player in America. So you expect that from him.
That's a career high now. 22 points for the sophomore, Greg Monroe. Nice work by Hayward. Extra pass. Penetration. Back to Hayward for three.
He's so good shooting the three, and he's really struggled early this year.
Fourth foul on Matt Howard. For more on Greg Monroe, here's Doris.
Well, Dick has been talking about increased assertiveness from this young man. John Thompson III will tell you he absolutely sees a difference, and it's moments like these when the game is on the line and he needs them to make plays. He's way up above everybody else. Dick, there was a moment against Temple when the ball had to go inside. He understood it was my time to make a play, and he did it. He's a willing passer, but there are moments where he's got to take over, Dick.
I agree with you, Doris. He's got to take over, just like you got to take over and take it away from me. I can't wait to work with Doris. We're going to do that game together, all of us down here for that women's game.
Notre Dame in Connecticut,
yes,
January the 16th.
Yeah. Skylar Diggins, can't wait to see that diaper dandy. Amaya Moore wants to be a Rhodes Scholar. Wow.
Shot clock at 10.
Hayward scored in double figures in every game this year, but he's not yet reached 20. Last year he had 27 against Curry and Davidson.
Monroe, no. Butler ball. Down by nine, just over 4 minutes to go. Indiana and Pittsburgh still to come.
Every possession bigger and bigger and bigger now.
Howard looking for contact, and he finds it. The foul on Monroe. Two more free throws coming for the Bulldogs.
It's the keys. If you can score and stop the clock, it's really a positive.
ESPN is your NBA destination. Tomorrow night, it'll be Derrick Rose and the Chicago Bulls taking on Joe Johnson and the Atlanta Hawks, a rising force in the Eastern Conference. Rose is better than 15 points, 5 assists per game. Joe Johnson is up over 21 points per game for Atlanta. And look who's back. Sheldon Mack is coming back in. That shoulder's feeling okay.
That's positive. Hey, I think when Gordon, back in 1979, being out here, first started the Big East, Dave Gavitt was a creator, innovator, yet coaching that league at the time. John Thompson, Jim Boeheim, Curtis Seca, Dr. Tom Davis, Billy Raftery was coaching Seton Hall, Gary Walters and Don Perno. Billy was wild on the sideline. I coached against him.
I can imagine.
With the two of us,
well,
we were two
left. He says the same about you, by the way.
We were two left. I'll tell you.
Under 4 minutes to go, the first game of two from the Jimmy V Classic with Dick Vitale and Doris Burke. I'm Dane Shulman. We've got Georgetown and Butler. The Hoyas have led most of the night, led by as many as 17 earlier in this game. It's down to 7 right now.
They got to come up with a defensive stop. Georgetown getting good spacing.
Chris Wright. And is that Howard? No basket. Matt Howard just fouled out of the game. The fifth time already this season of Matt Howard has fouled out of the game. Trouble for Brad Stevens and the Bulldogs as we look ahead to game two tonight. The Pitt Panthers are in the house getting ready to take on the Hoosiers in game two. Well, the frustration evident on the face of Matt Howard. He can't have a much more frustrating night than he's had. 1 for 9. He's fouled out again. Fifth time in 9 games this year that Matt Howard has fouled out of a game. Worked hard, just couldn't finish, couldn't stay out of foul trouble most of the night. Meanwhile, Georgetown, they've had a lot of foul trouble. 4 different players, each with 4 fouls. But at least to this point, Dick, it's hurt them, but it hasn't fully caught up to them. They've still got the lead.
Well, really hasn't hurt them because the key guy hasn't fouled.
Yep.
And that's Monroe. As long as Monroe's been on the floor, because he's the best player on the floor right now, just been dominating.
Monroe's played 34 minutes in this game already. 22 points, that's a career high. 12 rebounds.
See, Hayward normally makes those open threes. Another turnover.
21 turnovers committed by Georgetown.
They're doing everything they can to keep them in the game with those turnovers.
The cutter is Hayward. The pass doesn't get through. Right, coast to coast. And a block is called.
Knight's got that great speed. He looks like a running back the way he attacks the basket.
You talked about it. He's a huge key for them this year. His freshman season, remember, he got hurt, missed the whole Big East season last year. He played every game, but Jesse Sapp was there. But now this is his team. It's his time to lead this team, and he's so important for them.
Hey, Coach Shulman, you always put me on the spot. I'm going to put you on the spot. Right here, we sat,
yeah,
and we watched Syracuse.
Yep.
Right now, Syracuse, Georgetown. Who gets the edge?
Well, I think Syracuse.
Give Syracuse the edge. That 2-3 zone.
I'm not sure you and I have seen a team play better this year than Syracuse.
Yeah, they really played great. There's no doubt about it. But keep an eye on Villanova.
Yeah.
They got the deepest backcourt in America. I'll tell you one thing. They can shoot the three. You talk about Stokes, Fisher, Reynolds, who was brilliant against Maryland. Factor in Taylor King.
I'm looking forward to that Syracuse Florida game Thursday night. Jukes.
Don't forget West Virginia, yeah, either, man. Ebanks.
Boy, good defense by Clark. Good defense by Thompson. And a held ball. It'll be Georgetown ball. Jason Clark is everywhere defensively.
Yeah, he's done a great job here tonight. He's done a phenomenal job. Big East Commissioner smiling in the house right now, Mr. Marinato. There's that defensive presence inside. I think Thompson's going to really help them. He really is. The kid Hollis Thompson.
Yeah, because they need a little bit more from their bench. They're not a very deep team. And there's a foul that will send him on road to the line.
You know, mentioned Thompson is a great player out there. Michael Thompson's son, Clay Thompson, out of Washington State, man. Take a look at the Big East undefeated teams. But, you know, Seton Hall really hasn't played anybody, so we don't know. But we do know about West Virginia. We do know about Villanova. And we do know right now, certainly Syracuse. And Georgetown's letting us know that they're going to be legitimate. This is a good basketball team they're beating.
Now, Georgetown 6-0, their toughest win, a one-point win over Temple. Everybody else has been relatively easy wins. Now, they're playing a good Butler team, a ranked Butler team, and they're up 10 right now. Is this Georgetown team significantly better than last year's Georgetown?
You know, I don't know about significantly because, you know, you factor in DeJuan Summers last year, and they had those big wins, had that win over Connecticut with that great Connecticut team at Connecticut.
Yeah.
I mean, beat Memphis. Then they just got caught up into the toughness of the league, and you lose your confidence. You lose 3 in a row.
Back to kick. Hahn. Norad blocked by guess who? Clark, but it's called a foul. John Thompson does not like the call at all.
I don't blame him. You got a 10-point lead. Now you're going to give him 3 opportunities, and the clock, most of all, stops.
He got the ball clean. He got the arm after the ball was released. 3 shots coming now for Norad.
I don't know about that call. I really don't. There should be a no call there. Got to make these free throws. Got to make them right now down the stretch. It's a must. He's a must.
Norad, a sophomore out of Homewood, Alabama. Not a big scorer. A guy who was injured in the summer. Got a late start in practice. Didn't start the first 4 games of the year. Now Beasley will check in for Mack. Hahn will go out as well as Van Zandt comes in. And Brad Stevens making some offense-defense substitutions right now.
Yeah, Hahn comes in to shoot the 3. Hey, Stevens really handles the bench really well. He's got a good feel. He's probably at the perfect school. He's a heck of a player at DePaul. A little small school, was an outstanding scorer.
And you talk to older coaches, they've got a lot of respect for what Brad Stevens has done. They think that he's a terrific young coach. Good help there. Adam Monroe couldn't turn the corner, but he draws the foul. And we'll head back to the line.
He has been really impressive. I'll tell you one thing. He has been really impressive here.
A reminder, we're here for the Jimmy V Classic to raise funds for and awareness. All part of the V Foundation. 1-800-4-JIMMY-V, jimmyv.org. And coming up, the famous Jimmy V ESPY speech. You'll hear that between games one and two tonight. And then you'll hear my friend Mr. Vitale's speech at halftime of game two between Indiana and Pittsburgh.
You know, I'm going to talk about it at halftime. I'm going to tell you this now. It broke my heart. I was having breakfast at the Broken Egg, and the phone rang. And he called me up, the dad, Sergio Nagman. He said, "Dick, I want you to know my son just passed away 30 minutes ago, and I wanted to call you because you guys have been really close with him. He came to our gala. You've met him yourself." Anthony Nagrin, a big basketball lover, loved Carolina. At the funeral, everybody dressed basically Carolina outfits. But if people would have heard his voice, Dan, a father telling you his son just passed away, and his other son, his brother, has the same gene, but it hasn't been activated. So I beg you, you never know. It could be your son. It could be your daughter. It could be my granddaughters, my daughters. Please call 1-800-4-JIMMY-V. You might be saving the life of someone you love.
1-800-4-JIMMY-V, jimmyv.org. And again, every single dollar you donate goes directly to the V Foundation.
Is Monroe with that rebound again?
That last foul, by the way, on Butler was on Jukes. He's fouled out. The miss by Mack. Another rebound by Monroe. 23 points, 13 rebounds for Greg Monroe tonight.
You expect that out of him. You know, something else I'm going to talk about during my speech. Two other kids that lost their lives. You met them too. Peyton Wright. Yep. And then also, last year at our event, the Nichols family, they had a little girl. Caitlin, she passed away from cancer at age 3. Her twin sister, a year later, gets diagnosed with the same news. But Mr. Nichols told me the other day, sent a little message. My wife showed it to me. Great news that the cancer's in remission with the little girl, the sister. Wow.
As you have said so many times, it's something that affects all of us.
Everybody.
Every single person has somebody in their family or a friend who has dealt with cancer in one form or another.
It's devastating what it does to people. You go to a hospital ward and you visit little kids and you see them there, but it affects all, whether it be breast cancer, colon cancer, prostate cancer. I know the people at ESPN, I can't thank enough George Bodenheimer and Rosa Gatti and all the people at ESPN who've worked so hard. Please call 1-800-4-JIMMY-V. 1-800-4-JIMMY-V. I want to see us hit 100 million. I want to come back here with 100 million next year. And that's still way short of where we want to get, but it's getting closer. And as they were saying, John Saunders, every dollar that you donate, that's 60 cents, every dollar goes to research because of a $17 million endowment. That off that endowment, all the administrative costs are paid.
Career highs into both points and rebounds for Greg Monroe tonight. Hayward.
This game could be summarized one word, Monroe. The Monroe Doctrine has spoken. That's on the basketball court. See, I studied history.
That's pretty good.
I studied my history. The Monroe Doctrine has definitely spoken.
8-point game, a minute 40 to go. Georgetown will use the clock.
You know, Pittsburgh 7-1, by the way, coming in next game. I mean, they lost a lot of talent. By the way, Blair's playing well now for Pittsburgh with San Antonio.
He's playing terrific. Second-round pick. He's been a steal of the draft so far. Quick score here, and this one isn't over yet. Hayward. 6-point game.
I tell you, I just love Hayward's ability. He's had a tough time shooting the three.
Brad Stevens was trying to call a timeout, and the official didn't hear him.
You got a foul. Put him on a foul line. Stop the clock. Let him take too much time off that clock. Let him take too much time. I lost a lot of key seconds right there.
And now Freeman will go to the line for Georgetown. Watch Brad Stevens trying to get this timeout called.
Yeah, after the score, he's over to the official. He's trying to get the tee. Look at him right here. He's got to be a little bit more emphatic, though. You got to be a little more emphatic. Yeah, it's pretty emphatic, I guess. Pretty emphatic. My producer screaming in my ear, Dan Steer.
He's pretty
emphatic. Great job.
Yeah.
Pretty emphatic. He and Doug Holmes do a great job together. What a tandem in a truck. They make music together.
Freeman knocks down the first. Georgetown had missed 4 of its last 6 free throws.
Well, you got to hope to trade 2 for 3 now.
Yeah.
You got to hope to trade for 3. And if you're Georgetown, you know they're going to look for the 3. So you got to really extend the defense and make them put the ball on the floor and shoot 2s. You got to make them shoot 2s. You can't make them shoot 3s.
Valuable seconds ticking away.
Too long possession.
It'll be Hahn with a good look.
He gets it to go. Can't give him the three, man. Can't give him the three. Got to get in their face and make them bounce the ball and put it to the floor and shoot twos.
Well, if you're just joining us, the story of this game has been a career night for Georgetown sophomore Greg Monroe.
Jimmy V would love him. He's doing it all. There he is, spinning on a baseline. The reverse layup. Look at him attack the basket. So smooth. He's velvet. He's smooth. Silky smooth. Oh, I love this kid. This kid has got great bounce, great agility, mobility.
Sometimes a guy who looks for others more than himself, but he's been a little more assertive, a little more selfish tonight. Career highs in scoring and rebounding.
He's got a little bit more hostility in him. He's got to learn that from guys like Ewing and Mourning.
24 and 14 for Monroe, who has been on fire all night long. Less than a minute to go. Georgetown with the ball and a five-point lead, and any Butler foul would send the Hoyas to the line for two.
You got to foul, though. You got to foul quickly. You can't allow him to take it. You got to hope for the three. Got to hope for miss. You got to make the steal here or foul right away. That's smart. That's smart. You got to foul quickly. Stop the clock.
Less than a second comes off the clock.
Clock is not our enemy, man. Clock is not our enemy. No quitting these kids. He's a competitor, this guy. He's a competitor. He's trying to call the push there. He's really, you talk about being animated.
Here's Hollis Thompson, a freshman. No relation to the Thompson family. Head coach John Thompson and Big John.
See, free throws now become big. This young kid hasn't played a whole lot of competitive big-time basketball on a collegiate level. So right now he's in a pressure situation. Got to convert at least one. He comes up empty here. That's big. I mean, that's big for the Butler Bulldogs.
Six-point game.
Now you got two possessions right here. But when they can shoot the three, I mean, he's due to hit one, but you took Hayward. He's too skilled, too talented. It's that skip pass.
Mack for three. They got it back.
Great rebound.
Mack going inside. And that's been trouble all night long for the Bulldogs. Too much size and shot blocking for the Hoyas.
Did a great job rotating over again. That defensive ability. If you give out a gold trophy today for the star of stars, number 10 gets that trophy, baby. He gets that trophy. He's been a PTP and a primetime performer.
Doris Burke has more.
One of the things John Thompson has preached both to his local media and to his team is that this week is like a Big East week. We play a tough opponent on a Tuesday. They'll have Washington on Saturday. He said, listen, we were looking to get great preparation for a very tough Big East season upcoming by playing these types of games, Dick.
And I'm going to tell you this. When you look at Old Dominion and Harvard, that's not Cupcake City. Harvard really challenged Connecticut. The kid lived for Tommy Amicus Club.
30
scored
points.
30. And yep. I'll tell you, it was 6-1 going into that game. People say William & Mary. They beat William & Mary. Those are some good wins.
In and out for Hayward. Story of the night for Butler. And Freeman the steal. He's fouled by Norrett, and it's just about over. The Hoyas are on their way to a 7-0 record. And Butler, this is the third game the Bulldogs have played against a ranked opponent this year. And they're going to drop to 0-3 in those games. And they've got some more big games coming up, including Ohio State on ESPN on Saturday. And then Xavier. And both of those games are home games with the Buckeyes and the Musketeers both coming to Hinkle.
Well, you know, two talented basketball teams. Ohio State now is going to have some people step up. I think Lighty's going to step up for them. Fat Mata's done a fantastic job. The key to the game's been very simple. The star for Georgetown was the star. The star for Mr. Howard tonight was a subpar performance, yeah. And we know he's much better than what we saw here today. He really so effective inside. That was a big plus for Georgetown as we were able to really shut him down.
Great ball movement. Recovering quickly, too.
Look at that ball movement.
And Howard, or Hayward, excuse me, gets the three, and Brad Stevens will use a timeout. Less than 6 seconds to go, and this one's over.
The way he shot that, he looked like the kid from Fred Slick.
Hey,
in the
hey.
He did, the way he shot that. He really did. I mean, come on, now. There was definitely a little similarity.
And Hayward's got 24, although He's had to work hard for it. 7 of 19 from the field, 4 for 11 from three-point range.
Yeah, you know, when you take a look at his numbers, he's got 24, but it's not a real, what you call, a strong 24. He doesn't have a strong performance, a la Monroe's performance, he's talented.
Don't forget the speech from Jim Valvano from the ESPYs is coming up between games 1 and 2 here tonight before Indiana-Pittsburgh at halftime of Indiana-Pittsburgh. You'll hear Dick Vitale's speech as he talks to you about the importance of the V Foundation and the urgency with which we've all got to pick up the phone, get online, and make a donation.
To see people have to battle that disease, it breaks your heart. As one gets older, I'm 70 now, so many friends and so many people, the chemo, the radiation, not a happy time.
Monroe will save it and then just hang on to it, let the seconds expire. And the Georgetown Hoyas beat the Butler Bulldogs as the Hoyas go to 7-0 on the season.
Well, they really met the challenge here of a good quality competition, and they really survived because of the play of Monroe. He was absolutely sensational. I think Dar's going to get a chance to walk over and possibly talk with the star or talk with Coach Thompson.
Greg Monroe, career highs in points and rebounds as Gordon Hayward and the Butler Bulldogs fall to 6-3 on the season. They'll take on Ohio State on the weekend. Doris Burke standing by with John Thompson.
Coach Thompson, you said pregame that Butler would test you. What did you like about how your guys responded tonight?
Well, I like the way we, and I almost hate to say, the way we held on. You know, they made a run at us. We got composed. You know, we got to make our free throws better than that down the end. But I think our defensive execution got better. They have terrific shooters. They're so well coached that when you make a mistake, they score off of it. So I just thought we did a good job, particularly early in the second half where we were not scoring. I thought we did a good job of still getting stops at that point, which we were able to hold on.
You talked about Greg Monroe and increased aggressiveness. What did you see from him tonight?
I thought he did okay. I got to go back and look at it. You know, but the big fella did what he's supposed to do.
Coach, thank you very much. Congratulations.
Thank
Dan?
Yeah, he did okay.
He did okay.
He did okay, Coach.
He did okay. Hey, Coach, you got a W today. You better go hug that kid. You better give him a big hug and thank him.
24 points, 15 rebounds for Greg Monroe. Georgetown wins Indiana-Pittsburgh. Still to come, but first, here's John Saunders.
Guys, thanks a lot. Here we go.